Imagine you are an adorable black rat and you're eking out a living when you accidentally end up on a ship bound for a distant land, a tropical island in the Chagos Archipelago in the Indian Ocean. And life there is great. So great that you and all your rat buddies become an invasive species and wreak all sorts of havoc on the native wildlife. Last week in the journal Nature, Ecology, and Evolution, scientists proposed how these invasive rats can not only impact the happenings on land, they can also influence the behavior of fish. Jewel damselfish can be found farming in the coral reefs around the Chagos Islands, aggressively defending their small fields of algae turfs. Yes, you heard me right, these fish really do farm, pruning, pooping, and protecting their fields in a manner that makes them more productive. But these farms are especially worthy of defense because under typical circumstances, a lot of seabirds call the Chagos Archipelago home. These birds nest on the islands and do a lot of their own pooping there. That poop eventually washes out to sea, where it can provide oodles and oodles of delicious nitrogen fertilizer, making the algae chock full of nutrients. On some level, the fish know just how valuable this algae is, so they invest energy into defending their turf. They'll chase away other fish in high-speed bursts, bite them, and headbutt them, presumably because doing this is, like, harder when you're underwater. But back in the 1700s, ships carried invasive black rats to some of the islands. With no natural predators, they basically had their run of the place, and the native seabirds offered up a pretty easy feast. Today, the rat-free Chagos Islands have about 760 times as many birds as the invaded islands do. And fewer birds means less bird poop, so the team behind this study wanted to see what that decrease in bird poop meant for the fish farmers. In the coral reefs around 10 different islands, they installed GoPros to monitor the territory and behavior of 6 jewel damselfish. 5 of the islands were home to invasive rats, while the other 5 were rat-free. They also used the cameras to estimate the size of one fish's territory at each island. It turns out that fish near the rat-infested islands tended to have larger territories, and that's likely because the algae they were farming was less nutrient-dense. With fewer birds to contribute their fertilizing poop, each fish would have to farm more than their counterparts near rat-free islands to get the same amount of nutrients from their food. But interestingly, these fish with larger territories also tended to protect them less. They were less aggressive. Now, we cannot actually know the thoughts that are running through the brains of these fish. But the researchers interpreted this change in behavior as the fish deciding it just wasn't worth defending their algae as much if they're not getting this nutrient gold mine. That being said, maybe the fish whose farms got fewer poop nutrients were also choosing to spend more time farming, which would make less time available for fighting. Unfortunately, the researchers did not investigate their farming behavior. But the results of this experiment do at least suggest that invasive species on land have the ability to influence marine ecosystems, which the ultimate invasive species, us, can definitely also attest to. And having a bunch of gentler fish farmers is not the only outcome here. The jewel damselfish's behavior influences the social behaviors and space use of other fishes in the area, which means it's absolutely possible that the rat's impacts reach even farther than this. We'll just need some more follow-up studies with even more ocean-based GoPros to see just how strong an influence these small furry immigrants have on their new home. But black rats aren't the only invasive species in the news. Our second story looks not only at how an invasive species can impact ecosystems, but at how hard it can be for scientists to study how they spread. 2 weeks ago, in the journal Computers, Environment, and Urban Systems, one team explored how observations from news and social media could be used to help those scientists out. If you want to successfully control the spread of an invasive species, you gotta act fast. That requires lots of data about how pests have spread in the past, and up-to-the-minute data on how they're spreading now. And while field observations, official reports, and genetic records are often eventually available, getting through the red tape or peer review means they can be pretty delayed. So what's, like, super fast? Well, news and social media. Now, using these sources to supplement ecological observations, or as a kind of citizen science, isn't a new idea, but these researchers wanted to make sure it held up for invasive species, too. They picked 2 invasive insects, spotted lanternflies and tomato leaf miners. While the lanternflies are mostly a problem local to Pennsylvania and its neighboring states, the miners have spread all around the world. Because they're looking at invasions that have already happened, the team wanted to see if online aggregators aggregators like Google News could do a good job scraping sites and social media platforms, or at least Twitter, for old mentions of each pest. In addition to comparing a local versus global invasion, they also looked for mentions across different timescales, in different years, and across a whole decade. And while there was some variation between the three aggregators they tested, all of them were able to find tweets and news media mentions that provided accurate and useful information. Not only did the information generally match up with the stuff found in official sciencey sources, it also provided more specific details about when and where the insects had spread. Because people often had some pretty snarky things to say about how their governments were managing the situation, the authors noted that the tweets could help scientists understand how well different management strategies are being implemented. After all, what is social media for if not to post photos of your pets and complain about the government? But overall, this is good news. This research suggests that social and traditional news media could have an important role to play in getting citizen observations to researchers. Which is awesome, because honestly, we need all the help we can get to understand and combat the wild ways that invasive species can impact the ecosystems they join. And also, it's nice to hear about a way that social media is being used to do something that's not bad. Thanks for watching this episode of SciShow News. If you would like to learn more about invasive species, we have got you covered. Like this episode on weird ways we've fought off invasive species, or this one about how some non-native species aren't all bad. Just click to continue learning more about your world, because it doesn't actually take up any physical space in your brain. Maybe it does. Electrons aren't very big.